Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is net zero energy and transport. I'd invite members wishing to ask a supplementary question to press the request to speak buttons during the relevant questions. I'm aware of quite a bit of interest in questions this afternoon, so brevity in both questions and responses would be appreciated. And I call question number one, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it's had with ScotRail regarding the operation of a reduced train timetable.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
Transport Scotland holds regular discussions with Scottish Rail Holdings and the ScotRail Trains Limited to discuss a number of issues, including ScotRail's timetable. I am pleased that, like other rail unions, ASLEV members have voted to accept ScotRail's pay offer. ScotRail is expected to replace its current temporary timetable as soon as possible.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I know she will share the relief of myself and my constituents that this dispute has now been settled and our train drivers will be getting back to providing passengers with a fuller ScotRail timetable. Can I ask the Minister to ensure that ScotRail circulate information about reinstated services as quickly as possible to ensure that the travelling public are aware of how Scotland's public-loaned railway will meet their needs?
Cabinet Secretary.
I will indeed. Obviously, they need to do some initial planning to ensure that the timetable can be reintroduced, and I will impress on them the desire from MSPs to understand that and to communicate with them. Can I also, President Officer, take the opportunity to remind members that I have written to every single member of the Parliament with information about their own region and what the new discounted fares that will start from Monday would enable their constituents to benefit from, and so I would ask them to help publicise that and also ScotRail's communication of the new discounted fares as well as the new timetable when it's released.
Supplementary, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you very much. Transport Focus survey shows that satisfaction with the frequency of ScotRail trains is in the bottom half across the UK. Hopefully that will improve. The Cabinet Secretary says she wants to see the timetable reinstated as soon as possible. What does she mean by that? Can she be more specific?
Cabinet Secretary.
In the next week or so.
Thank you. Question two, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the Just Transition Commission's recent report on the future of Grangemouth.
Minister Alistair Allen.
The Scottish Government welcomes the report prepared by the Just Transition Commission regarding the future of Grangemouth Industrial Cluster, and the Acting Cabinet Secretary for Energy and Net Zero wrote to the Commission's co-chairs earlier this year to express this. The Scottish Government has considered these proposals in the drafting of the Grangemouth Industrial Just Transition Plan, which will be published for consultation in due course. I should note that the nature of some proposals are far-reaching and will require consideration by a wider set of stakeholders regarding practical implementation, particularly across the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. I look forward to further working with the JTC on how this can be achieved.
Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Minister for that reply and welcome, I think, the tone of what he has said as well as its content. So one of the key findings of the Just Transition Commission's report is that the people of Grangemouth want more than just warm words. So can he elaborate on his response? The report stated that GFIB must have clear, actionable and measurable commitments from all parties going beyond business as usual. It emphasised the credibility of the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth hinges on transparent accountability. So will this report, will the Minister confirm, this plan that will be published will include commitments, actions, timelines and deadlines?
Minister.
Yes, I can confirm that it will, and some of the themes that the member mentions that came through in the report to us were that it must earn the trust of the workers themselves, that it must be the first in a series of just transition plans for different parts of the Scottish economy, and that a new intergenerational social contract is needed to ensure that Grangemouth itself feels the benefit and that that extends to the whole region. The other point I would wish to make, and I appreciate the member realises this, is that this is all in addition to the more immediate interventions that are taking place in and around Grangemouth just now in consultation with the UK Government.
A couple of supplementaries. First, David Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our thoughts are with the workforce and their families during such a worrying time, and it's welcome that the Scottish and the UK governments have since announced a further £20 million, in addition to the £80 million joint-funded Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal. Can the Minister say any more about the plans for his funding and the opportunities it will create?
Minister.
Thank you. I would certainly echo David Torrance's concerns for the workforce and families at Grangemouth, and that's why we are supportive of the UK Government matching our long-standing commitment to Grangemouth through their recent £10 million additional funding announcement for the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal. This releases £100 million of combined government investment over the next 10 years and will enhance and protect Grangemouth's manufacturing and petrochemical cluster to ensure it continues to be of strategic importance. Projects such as the Grangemouth Sustainable Manufacturing Campus will aid Grangemouth's transition to net zero, whilst the Greener Grangemouth programme will deliver activity focused on regeneration and community wealth building alongside skills investment. We are working alongside the UK Government, who are yet to outline the specific focus of their additional funding. However, we will continue to press that it is supportive of fuel security and sustainability.
And for the supplementary, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. The Commission's report advised that the process of developing just transition plans for other industrial sites that are linked to Grangemouth, such as Mossmorran, should begin as a matter of urgency. I'll be hosting a worker-led summit with unions, operators, decision-makers in December to start a meaningful conversation on the development of a worker-led just transition plan for Mossmorran. So can I invite the Minister, indeed the Cabinet Secretary, to join me and all those stakeholders in a vital conversation at the summit later on this year?
Minister.
I thank the member for that contribution and that the helpful point he makes around Mossmorran. The government is very much cognisant of the role of Mossmorran and its need for its own just transition plan and its own specific engagement, and that engagement is already underway.
Thank you. Question three, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and refer members to my register of interest regarding onshore wind. To ask the Scottish Government when it last engaged with the Four Nations Steering Group on the review of noise guidance for onshore wind turbines as it applies to Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin.
Scottish Government officials continue to engage on a regular basis in the UK Government-led process to update the ETSU R97 noise guidance, with the latest engagement being in August of this year.
Alexander Burnett.
Well, regarding the review of ETSU R97 on noise guidance, my constituent asked the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero how authorities should act with regard to evidence that will form part of that review when determining applications before the review process is complete. And the UK Government's response was very clear, stating that decision makers can consider other relevant evidence and may depart from existing policy and guidance if there is a rational justification for doing so. So the Acting Cabinet Secretary confirmed today that she will recognise the recommendations in the WSP report and act accordingly in making determinations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Of course, any noise complaints can be reported to the relevant local authority and be investigated under the Environmental Protection Act. And there are also provisions under the Town and Country Planning Act, and any breach of consent conditions on noise can be investigated under that. But I'll take on board the comments that Mr Burnett has said.
And supplementary, Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, we clearly need to work alongside communities, protect our natural environment, as well as drive forward with decarbonation and green economic growth if Scotland and the UK is to comply with the Independent Climate Change Committee's advice that electricity from onshore wind must double by 2030 to meet net zero targets. Cabinet Secretary, how does the Scottish Government seek to strike the correct balance in that vital endeavour?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Dorris for that question. Scotland's potential for renewable energy generation, as he says, is one of our greatest environmental and economic opportunities. And the recent programme for government set out our ambition to double renewable electricity capacity with actions to deliver on our clean energy pipeline and its many benefits. As part of our just transition, we will prioritise community benefits, skills, supply chains, energy efficiency and decarbonisation projects. I was also pleased recently to launch, alongside the Deputy First Minister, the Green Industrial Strategy, which focuses specifically on seizing the economic opportunities of the global transition to net zero.
Question four, Claire Adamson.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what engagement it has had with the UK Government regarding action to address the impact in Scotland of the rising energy price cap, which will increase by 10% in October.
Cabinet Secretary Gillian Martin.
The news that energy prices are to rise by 10% next month is of deep concern. Following its extremely disappointing cut to the winter fuel payment, we encourage the new UK government to do more to increase take-up of pension credit and will engage with it again ahead of the budget. Meanwhile, though, we are forming a working group in Scotland with key energy suppliers aimed at co-designing a social energy tariff. And this would provide more affordable energy tariffs to those in most need. And we continue to urge the UK government to introduce such a mechanism.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer. Can I say that I am very concerned for my constituents in Motherwell and Wisham, many of whom are the most vulnerable customers who suffer from higher tariffs, from debt being put to the front of the meters and practices that really do penalise the most vulnerable in our constituencies. So I welcome very much the working party and I look forward to further detail on that. But can the Minister also join me in reminding people to submit their meter readings or photograph their meetings before the 1st of October so that they won't be unduly penalised by mistakes from the fuel companies? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
I absolutely am happy to echo that important reminder that Claire Adamson has just given around meter readings and take on points, other points she's made. These increased bills demonstrate why the UK government must urgently agree to deliver a social tariff. I'll say that we are already committed to working with the UK government to make this a reality. The core purpose of our working group is to be able to enable industry and government to develop that shared understanding beyond the broad principles of how to deliver this crucial policy. But can I also say to Claire Adamson that if she can join me and anyone that has any kind of pressing concerns around their energy bill, that help is available if they contact the Scottish Government-funded Advice Direct Scotland.
Thank you. Question 5, Annabel Ewing.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its policy is on upgrading the infrastructure of ports.
Cabinet Secretary Fiona Hislop.
We recognise how crucial the Scottish port sector is to our economy and in supporting lifeline ferry services. Scottish ports are mostly independent statutory bodies and hence deemed independent commercial entities. The Scottish Government has no role in their day-to-day operations nor business decisions such as upgrading of infrastructure. Exceptionally, the Scottish Government provides grants towards significant upgrades at ports used by ferry services under the Clyde and Hebrides and Northern Isles contracts. This ensures these ports remain safe and operable for contracted ferry services, can accommodate increasing traffic and become more accessible to a range of vessels.
Annabel Ewing.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that there are, in fact, ongoing discussions about the re-establishment of a freight and passenger ferry from the port of Rosyth to Dunkirk, the third largest port in France. Will the Cabinet Secretary now agree to meet with DFDS and their representatives to discuss the current status of this exciting project? And will she in fact consider, in light of the same, what upgrades to port infrastructure may in fact be required, leaving to one side who would be doing it, but what may be required in order to boost exports and tourism through direct maritime links with the EU?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I am aware of the proposal to explore the viability of a Rosyth to Dunkirk ferry service. I've already met with individuals who are promoting the proposal. Transport Scotland officials have continued that dialogue. If there are any new specific developments which the Scottish Government can assist with, then a meeting may be appropriate. Of course, Forth Ports are a private port operator and any decision to invest in their infrastructure is for them to decide in liaison with their commercial shipping partners, and I suggest including DFDS in relation to the request for what scoping would be required of what would be required for that business and exports, and with consideration of the potential return on investment that they would benefit from. And of course, the Scottish Government and the UK Government have supported Forth Ports through the creation of Forth Green Port Freeport site. That includes Rosyth, so that includes seed capital funding along with businesses locating within the tax site being able to access a package of devolved and reserved tax incentive. So I think that should assist the Port of Rosyth in continuing to be an attractive place and for any future developments such as with DFDS.
Okay, supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, it's been 7 months since I first raised the issue of the Irish berth at Ardrossan Harbour going offline for safety reasons. That principally is the reason that the MV Alfred is now operating out of Troon and not Ardrossan as it should be. But it's been 7 years since this SNP government promised action on the entire port infrastructure at Ardrossan. 7 whole years and a decision is yet to be made. My question, therefore, is a simple one. When will a decision be made on this vital upgrade to Ardrossan Harbour? And by when, I mean by which date?
Cabinet Secretary.
I know the member wants a date. I would like a date, but we need to ensure that we have the business plan in a robust method, including critical legal and financial issues that have been changing recently, which are not the responsibility of the Scottish Government. He refers to the Irish berth. He will also know that, again, in reference to my initial answer to Annabel Ewing, ports are privately owned by and large. They're independent. Peel Ports have the responsibility and had the responsibility to keep the Irish berth in the state it should be required. That itself is a material factor in anticipating what the work that needs to be done. The Peel Ports, of course, are part of the task force, are part of the discussions. So I think the solution to Ardrossan needs to be one that can be depended on. It has to require the cooperation of the current partners. Should that situation change anytime soon, I will let him know. But I appreciate his frustration, which I, as Transport Secretary, also share.
Question 6, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government regarding implementation of its heat and building strategy, what discussions it is having with the UK Government on consumer protection in light of reported concerns that customers currently using heat networks are not protected by Ofgem's price cap.
Minister Alistair Allan.
Although heat networks are devolved to the Scottish Parliament, consumer protection remains a reserved matter and we are therefore reliant on the UK Government enacting provisions on consumer protection contained in the Energy Act 2023. We await the new UK Government's next steps on this. The Scottish Government continues to work closely with the UK and Welsh Governments and with Ofgem on the implementation of consumer standards, participating in a quadripartite group overseeing the implementation of the legislation.
Ben McPherson.
I welcome that proactive work from the Scottish Government because constituents have written to me and I know other MSPs explaining that they are currently facing an upwards of 500% increase to their district heating costs by their property factors. And the lack of consumer protection in this area leaves customers vulnerable to market forces. My constituents are worried about their ability to pay their energy bills this winter. Sadly, as has been set out, this Parliament lacks the legislative power to change energy policy in this area. So considering this, will the Scottish Government continue to press the UK Government to take action as soon as possible, as this Parliament is unable to? And can any pressure be applied to property factors to engage more with parliamentarians so that together we can help our affected constituents?
Minister.
Thank you. I hear Ben McPherson's concerns and think I may know the area of Edinburgh that he is probably referring to. And as he has himself mentioned, this Parliament lacks the legislative power to change energy policy in this area. It is disappointing that we haven't seen the UK Government take quicker action to protect consumers reliant on heat networks for heating and hot water. But I will raise this as a matter of urgency with my counterparts in the UK Government and will certainly correspond with the member on some of the issues that he raises.
My supplementary, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Mr McPherson raises important points about consumer protections in relation to the Scottish Government's heat and building strategy implementation. Ministry leaders have expressed concerns that the current differing patchwork of quality assurance and consumer protection schemes make it unclear what accreditation is needed for government energy efficiency funding. So will the government introduce mandatory quality assurance accreditation in the Heat and Buildings Bill, and will there be sufficient time allowed for industry to adjust and obtain these accreditations?
Minister.
Thank you. While the member wouldn't expect me to preempt any announcement about what might be in future legislation in any detail here, we are continuing to implement the Heat Networks Scotland Act. We have passed the Heat Networks Zones and Buildings Assessment Report Scotland Regulations 2023, which will help local authorities and the Scottish Government to identify opportunities for heat network developments across Scotland, and we will shortly consult on proposals to introduce a proportionate licensing and consenting system for Scotland, which I hope might address some of the issues that the member raises.
And question 7, Sue Webber.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what financial impact its proposed Heat and Buildings Bill will have on homeowners.
Minister.
This year's programme for government committed to bring forward a heat and buildings bill, which will be accompanied by a financial memorandum and all other relevant impact assessments. We intend this to be deliverable and affordable for households and businesses. We continue to offer the most generous package of funding in the UK for households to transition to clean heating, with various schemes to support those with difficulty paying their fuel bills. We also need action, of course, from the new UK government to rebalance gas and electricity prices, an essential part of making the transition more affordable.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Minister for that response. The reality is that for thousands of Victorian tenements in densely populated parts of our cities, like Leith and Partick, or in cottages and homes across the country, the costs of meeting the standards outlined in the bill are not deliverable and affordable. They are of a scale that neither the individual nor the Scottish Government can ever dream of affording. Owners could in fact be blocked from selling their homes, having a catastrophic impact on the property market and on the lives of those trapped in homes they cannot sell. Does the Minister accept that this proposal would aggravate Scotland's housing crisis, and will the Minister commit to introducing appropriate exemptions to the proposed scheme?
Minister.
I thank the Member for the points that she makes, and she rightly says that perhaps not all costs associated with our transition to a clean future can ever be met entirely by government. I think what I would really add, though, to what she's said is that the Member quite legitimately often comes, and her party quite often come to this Parliament asking us what more Scotland can do and our Government can do to meet our ambitious targets on decarbonising the country. 20% of the carbon emissions from Scotland come from houses, so I hope that she will not oppose every measure that is brought to this Parliament to try to address that problem.
Supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The previously mentioned Heat and Buildings Bill will be vital in helping meet our climate goals, providing energy-efficient insulation solutions and clean green heat. Can the Minister say any more about what assessment the Scottish Government has made on how this will reduce emissions and heating bills?
Minister.
Our recent consultation highlighted the potential of a switch to clean heating and more energy-efficient homes to reduce our exposure to the spikes in fossil fuel prices that have driven the recent surge in energy costs. Any bill that we bring forward will be accompanied by a financial memorandum and all other relevant impact assessments, which will consider these issues and impacts in more detail.
And question 8, Gordon MacDonald.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its efforts to develop a world-leading green hydrogen sector.
Minister Alistair Allan.
Hydrogen is a key part of our net zero journey. We remain committed to developing a world-leading green hydrogen sector in Scotland. We continue to engage with hydrogen projects across Scotland, working with them to develop their production, offtake and export capabilities. The levers available to the UK Government, particularly regarding production, regulation and trade, are critical to ensuring that Scottish companies benefit from domestic and global market opportunities. We continue to work with UK counterparts to ensure that the Scottish hydrogen sector is best positioned to take forward this critical work to support net zero targets.
Gordon MacDonald.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Given that a successful transition to a green hydrogen economy would be transformative in the race to net zero, does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that in order to meet the cost of this transition, the Labour Government must reverse its abandonment of the £28 billion Green Investment Pledge and step up to meet our ambitions for the sector?
Minister.
Well, in Scotland, we are creating the right conditions to realise the opportunities that the just transition to net zero presents for our workers and for our economy. And our Green Industrial Strategy, published earlier this month, sets out how we're creating an environment which encourages just that investment, including in hydrogen. Now, as the Member suggests, we are limited in the fiscal levers that we're able to deploy to support these ambitions in Scotland. And we would absolutely welcome, of course, further investment by the UK Government.
And brief supplementary, Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I ask the Minister what plans there are to use hydrogen in the rail network?
Minister.
Well, there are, as I said, I'm not in a position to talk in detail about future legislation, nor am I probably in a position to talk knowledgeably about some of the issues that he raises there, but I will correspond with the Member.
Thank you very much. That concludes portfolio questions on net zero energy and transport. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow the front benches to change.